So just one time, Apple, send me an operating system update that makes me feel like it was a good thing that you sent me an operating update and not a disaster.
So what happened, Steve?
Oh, are we live? We're live.
I think
so. Hey, folks. How you doing? What happened was that last night before I went to bed, there was an operating update, an operating system update for my Mac, my iMac. So I said, okay, do it. And then it restarted. And then I was working over at my desk over there, which no one can see. And then you said, hey, time for sound check. I went, yeah, no problem. I went over here and it was clear that it needed to be rebooted again. So I rebooted it again. And then it not only took like three times longer than a normal reboot, but when it got moving, nothing was working. So I had to reboot it again. And still, to this time, my mouse doesn't work.
It's like, nice.
Like nothing's functioning. So we're lucky we're doing a show at all, guys.
Yeah, are we on at all? Are people on? Is anybody watching?
We're on. Yeah, there are people. There's nine people watching
right now.
And they're what is going on here with Steve's rant?
I'm going to pull it up and see on YouTube how it looks. Yeah, okay. And are we on Facebook too, or is there still an issue
with
that?
Looks like Facebook is cooperating with us tonight.
All right.
So, very good.
I was thinking, I mean, we could try and do a throwback to when we used to do our you know, live stream dueling shows and do a song together, maybe. But since we haven't practiced it, maybe it.
I'm more interested in just, you know, like picking your brain and seeing what's on your mind. How's your week, by the way?
It's good. It's been very busy.
Right.
Busy is good. And I got something very new, exciting. I got a new computer.
I hope it's working better than mine was.
It's working incredibly. It's like butter.
Right. Rub it in my face.
I know. I don't mean to. It's gorgeous.
All right. Well,
it's a work of art.
Tell you what, we've spent just enough time now. It looks like we've got sort of a nice little collection of our first group of viewers. So I think I'm going to let you open the proceedings tonight. What do you have? What do you want to play? And tell me, why do you want to play it? Tell me about the song.
Yeah, I mean, so this show is about playing some of our favorite songs, right? Or stuff that we're really into at the moment or loved at one time that was inspiring. So I'm going to do something shocking. Are you ready?
Okay.
I'm going to play one of my all-time favorite songs that I've probably played more than the person who wrote it has played it. So this is a little tune called Scenes from an Italian Restaurant.
I highly doubt you've played it more times than he has, though. Just throwing that out there.
Let's return to that idea afterwards, because we can probably do a rough calculation. A bottle of white, a bottle of red, perhaps a bottle of rosé instead. We'll get a table near the street in our old familiar place, you and I face to face. A bottle of red, a bottle of white. It all depends upon your appetite. I'll meet you anytime you want in our Italian restaurant. Thank you.
up in the stairs, and the king and the queen get at the prom. Riding around with the cop top down and the radio on. Nobody looked any finer. It was more of a hit at the Parkway Diner. We never knew we could want more than that out of life. Oh, but there we were waving, wondering it goodbye. Said they were crazy, but you know that you're much too lazy, and that you can never afford to live that kind of life. Oh, but there we were waving, wondering it goodbye.
I've only played this song 1,000 times. Ah, fuck it. Whatever.
Oh, go. Dude. First of all, the playing was exquisite in spite of the fact that you completely forgot how the song goes.
That was insane.
One of the things I love most about working with you is that you have a very different it's weird. We use like the same kind of approach to how we play piano, but you have a very different, like, your mind works differently in your licks and your fills and like the way the rhythm patterns and things that you choose. And so it's always interesting to hear you interpret a song that I've played a lot of times, because I get to see how somebody else is doing it. And it sounds like equally similar to, you know, the recording. Well, not this time, because you forgot.
That was insane. I don't even know
what section.
I was completely lost.
That's okay. That's just clearly a sign that you're working too hard.
Yeah, you know what it is that last time, and I got to stop doing this. Our idea, or at least my initial idea, was who cares what people want to hear? I want to play what I want to play. But that seems to creep in a little bit. I'm like, well, yeah, Scenes from an Italian Restaurant, It's definitely one of my all-time favorite songs, but I've played it to death, and I never really want to play it. But I was like, oh, let me play it tonight. And you know what? I shouldn't have done it. I shouldn't have. I'm deleting that entirely.
So what you're saying is this was the result of people pleasing.
Exactly.
Well,
you know.
For what it's worth, I was really enjoying the piano playing in particular because, as I said, it's like I get to see what somebody else's brain, does in those moments when you're making choices about licks and fills. For those of you who are students of mine, we hope sometime this summer to do a little friendly collaboration on a little mini course where we're going to teach some of Kevin's licks, because I've pretty much taught everything that I know. I'm out of good ideas.
I just want to say hello to George, you sick bastard, and Josh. Thanks for tuning in.
All right. Right on. Thomas, how you doing? Pastor Norman, thanks for being here with us. So, Here's what I'm going to do tonight. So I've kind of been on a roll with Elton John here lately because it was his birthday on Monday. We did an all Elton John stream on Sunday, all requests, and it was great fun. But there were some that I would have liked to have played that I didn't get to because there were just so many requests that by the time I got done with everybody's wish list, I just didn't get to some of the stuff. And so I wanted to, but I thought that this would be kind of a fun thing to visit with you about for a second before I get launched into my first one. So I've been kind of thinking about Elton, because Elton's career is probably like, I don't know that his music is more meaningful to me than Billy Joel's. It's close, but I think Billy Joel's catalog is still sort of like the gold standard for me, for my influence, you know?
Same.
I don't know anybody else that just sort of nailed even the deep cuts so well. But Elton's career is something that I'm just absolutely in awe of, because he just never lost the desire to keep like creating, and he maintained, like, even as his like body couldn't do things that it used to do and his voice changed and.
Like the somersaults off the piano?
Yeah, exactly. But he just sort of maintained like this like best possible version of himself all the way to the retirement like tour. And it was really fun to watch. And I never didn't enjoy myself from beginning to end at an Elton show, because he just always sort of like, he just always was solid delivery all
oh,
the
yeah.
time.
And always.
And I think there are like four distinct eras from his career, and I even gave them labels. You tell me what you think of these. So I call the first one Breakout Star, which is like from the beginning through about 76, and when the bulk of his biggest hits came out and he was sort of the biggest thing in music. And then he kind of intentionally pumped the brakes and cooled things off, and he and Bernie took a little time off writing together. And then I call the second swing from about 1979 through about 86, 87. I call that Season Pro, because it wasn't really old yet, but it was just like, you know, the guy doesn't know how not to churn out hits,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
And so you get like your I'm Still Standing. Guess that's why they call it the blues era, that kind of thing. Then he had the vocal problems.
Mm-hmm.
He lost his voice, had surgery, and his voice changed. And he was really, really in need of going through rehab. And I think a new era started in about 1989 with the Sleeping with the Past album.
What was on that one?
That was Sacrifice, Club at the End of the Street, Healing Hands, that era.
Yeah.
And I'm like, to me, that I call this era aging like a fine wine, because then through the 90s and stuff, he continued to have hits.
Yeah.
Like 20 years later. But they weren't.
The one.
They weren't as massive of hits, except for The Lion King, but they were like solid. Like, how many 45-year-old, 47-year-old dudes are like running around?
Not today, that's for sure.
Hitting in the top 20 on the regular. And I thought like that era actually is sort of like my sentimental favorite, because he's just, I think that music is a little underrated but you know.
So reveal the era that you're gonna play a song from, and I'm gonna try to guess what song it is.
I'm gonna focus tonight on Aging Like a Fine Wine, which I think came to a conclusion with Songs from the West Coast.
Okay.
And then the final swing after Songs from the West Coast, I call the Legacy Period, which is
so
less known stuff.
Can I take a guess then?
You take a guess.
I think you're gonna do Club at the End of the Street.
You're wrong.
Ah.
But right, that's a really good one.
One more
guess.
That's
a really good one. One more guess.
Now, can you give me a hint? Like, is it going to be a, was it a big hit or kind of a minor hit?
It was a top 20.
Hmm. And it could be the one, but it could also be Blessed or Sacrifice. Any of those?
I've considered those, and I haven't entirely decided which ones I'm going to do all throughout the night, but the one I wanted to start with was the one that we put a Sunday, Robbie and I put a Sunday jam out on this one, and I'm not doing this just to promote that, by the way. I'm not that soulless. I just love this song.
That sounded like Believe that you just pressed the chord, right?
Right, and Believe is a song that kind of became the theme song for his AIDS Foundation.
Ah, cool.
Which is really...
That's a great one.
So, anyway, this is from 1995 off the Made in England album. So
cool.
I'm going to send you away for a moment, and I'll bring you back. All right. Let me bring the words up here quick, because, of course, I don't know them. All right, here we go.
But love.
Thank you, sir.
Nice. That's a great song.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's a little bit, it was a little lost on me when it first came out when I was like 16. But it's pretty poignant now that I'm old enough to understand what it's about.
Yeah, yeah. That's the Made in England. I actually like the title track on that album too, which wasn't a big hit. It was in, I think they played it on the, did you ever see the Tantrums and Tiaras documentary?
Yeah.
Which is it's fantastic.
I think that actually is a pretty good album from top to bottom, which I don't normally think about Elton John albums. I usually think that there's like two really good songs and three kind of good songs and then five that I could live without. But I actually can listen to that one from beginning to end.
Yeah, you know what I rewatched the other day was the documentary of the Union with Leon Russell.
Leon Russell. You know what? I have to plead guilty. I have not only not seen that, I've never listened. I've never taken the time to listen to the record.
Oh, you should, because it's Elton John. Sorry, someone just messaged me something. I messaged someone that I know who I thought was watching on YouTube. And I called them a sick bastard, but it's not them earlier. So apologies. So I was saying it's Elton John production like you've never heard on any of his other albums, even songs from the West Coast. It's even more kind of old school, very non-digital.
Well, I figured it'd be pretty earthy.
Earthy is the word. Yeah, and they didn't use his band. They use all these different. They use like Jim Keltner on the drums and a couple of these other really amazing musicians.
Probably tried to put the remaining members of the Wrecking Crew together since Leon was there.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if any of those guys were on there. They may have been actually, but I'm gonna send you the link because it used to be on HBO, but I forget where I saw it recently. Maybe it was on YouTube. It's really really good. Now this, you listen to the album and you're not like, man, these are amazing songs. No, it was more of like a cool collaboration of these two guys that once knew each other when life for each of them was very, very different.
Right.
Leon Russell was a big star.
And Elton was like just in awe of him. Like, yeah. I remember Elton telling the story when he played at the Troubadour Club in L.A.
Yeah.
You know, like, which is his breakout. They played 60 Years On, and it was like just this massive moment, and it really like introduced him to America. And he was so nervous because he was like, Leon Russell's in the front row of this thing, and I'm afraid he's going to come up on the stage and go, get the hell out of here, kid. This is how you play the piano. You know?
And Leon Russell in the documentary says, when Elton came out and started playing, I knew in that moment that my career was over. And he said in a really sincere way, and in many ways it kind of was. Not that there wasn't room for both of them, but you know, Elton went the way that he did, and Leon Russell kind of just...
Well, you know, you think about, like, Billy Joel as the other person who was really identified with piano that actually had a big career in that same time, and you think about when Billy finally broke out big. Like, Piano Man was this really minor hit in 1974, but he did not really score big until Elton pumped the brakes on his career. Elton through 76 was like everything, everywhere, all the time. And the Stranger album hit the market in 77. And then it was like there was room, there was a lane for a piano man to come out and kind of take that, fill the void.
Yeah, and the other day, Billy Joel was on the Howard Stern show, and he told a... It's funny because you watch Billy Joel interviews from the past 50 years, and it's a lot of the same stories with the same...
Which is why I don't watch a lot of them anymore.
But every once in a while, you get a good interviewer like Howard Stern, and he'll get something out of him. But Billy Joel told a story that I had never heard before, that when he went to record, I think it was either Turnstiles, which he produced himself. I forget if it was Turnstiles or Streetlight Serenade or something like that, that George Martin wanted to produce. He wanted George Martin to produce the album.
Right.
But then...
he wouldn't let him use his own band.
Right. So I had heard that story. But maybe it was before that a management company that Billy Joel was with at the time had said, you got to use Elton's band to record your music. Because Elton John has a bunch of hits, and you play the piano, and Elton John plays the piano. And Billy was like, no, why the hell would I do that? He's doing a whole different thing. And I had never heard that before, that it was suggested to him and pushed on him to use Elton's band at the time. So if you could imagine that, it would be kind of weird. He liked the kind of rough, unpolished sound of Liberty, DeVito, and the rest of those guys. Russell Jabbers.
It's a very New York sounding group.
Oh, yeah.
So...
Yeah.
Well,
so,
very cool. Hey, let's just say hi to a couple people here quick and acknowledge their presence, and then you can carry on with another song. But
okay.
Our friend Thomas George is here, who comes to pretty much all of my live streams. Hey, Thomas, good to have you.
That's the
with
one
us.
That I called a bastard. I'm sorry. I have a friend named George Thomas, and I thought that was him. So apologies, Thomas George.
Yeah, no worries. And Norm is here. Norm Nix is here. Josh G is here. I think that's another one of your friends.
Oh, yeah. Josh is he's actually, I have a podcast business, and Josh is a dream client and a friend now. So thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you, Josh, for
is
being
he
there.
As good a friend to you as I am? Because that will make me a little jealous.
Well, now you're putting me on the spot, because I have he's a client. You're not paying my bills, Steve.
Well, and I never will.
Right.
Okay. and Steph is here. Steph Dean.
Hi, Steph.
Nice. I saw Elton on his farewell tour twice. Even though he's not physically active much anymore, he always finds a great way to make up for it. I totally agree. Totally agree. That's MNH guy. Okay. And he guessed it correct. Believe. Oh, Bill Hasty, one of my regulars. Outstanding, Bill. Thank you very much. And, oh, Charlotte's here, one of my favorite people in the world. And
hello.
I do not know you, but hello as well. All right.
And hi to Bill. Bill says, how you doing, KL? Getting warm down there. Yes, it is.
Kayla hugs. Okay. Good to have you with us. All right. And our friend Gary Elgort in Nevada is here. How you doing, bud? And Operation Shutdown. Thank you very much. All right,
who's
Kevin,
that?
What you got for us, man?
I'm going to do a Dire Straits song.
Right on. Yeah. Well, let me get out of your way so that you can wow us all.
Well, I don't know about that.
Sad. Some people can be bad. The things they do, the things they say. But baby, I wipe away those bitter tears. I chase away those restless fears. Turn your blue skies into gray. Why worry? There should be laughter after pain. This should be sunshine after rain. These things have always been the same. So why worry now? Baby, when I get down, I turn to you. You make sense of what I do. And now I know it's hard to say. But baby, just when this world seems mean and cold, my love's come shining red and gold. All the rest is by the way. Why worry? There should be laughter after pain. There should be sunshine after rain. These things have always been the same. So why worry?
Thank you.
I've never heard that one, man.
Really?
Like, yeah. No, I'm not terribly familiar with Dire Straits. I mean, other than like The Walk of Life and...
It's on that same album, Brothers in Arms.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that's an amazing album.
What's the other big one that they had?
Money for Nothing.
Money for Nothing and that one and Sultans of Swing. And
yeah. And then there's... Sultans of Swing is on a different album, I think. I'm not sure which one that one is on. But it's a really simple song, but I love it. Love that.
Yeah, well, actually, to me, it kind of sounds a little bit like a Broadway song. You know, it's got a little bit of a musical theater taste to it.
Interesting. I mean, maybe listen to the recording, and you won't get that vibe. Maybe that was just my shitty interpretation.
Well, maybe I wasn't insulting it by saying.
Yeah, it's okay.
But, okay, well, awesome. And yeah. I'm going to carry on with... I'm going to stay, like I said, I'm going to kind of focus on this aging like an old, like a good wine.
Oh, you're saying on Elton?
Yeah, I'm just going to kind of vibe on Elton tonight, which doesn't have to do anything with what Kevin's going to play. We don't consult with each other at all on this.
No, we were supposed to have a little pre-show meeting around 5, but I was just sitting here staring at my beautiful new computer.
Yeah, that was working wonderfully. While I was trying to survive an operating system update.
Yeah.
Anyway, but yeah, I'm going to stick with Elton tonight, and I'm going to kind of stick in that particular era because there's two things that have converged in my life. One, when Elton's voice changed after that surgery, it very much became similar to my voice. Like the range, and his voice deepened a little bit in timbre, and he became kind of a power punch singer. As opposed to when he was younger, when he was a little, like, doing a lot more falsettos and a lot more, you know, it was just a different kind of vocal style, but he had to start writing songs for the voice that he had. And so I really became fond of this era of music. And I think one of the best songs he's written in his entire career was on the 2001 Songs from the West Coast that they made in California.
Is that what you're playing? You're
going
to play something? Okay, so can I guess this one?
You can guess.
This Train Don't Stop There Anymore?
I thought about it, but there's one I love more than that.
All right, hold on. list out the songs for me in order from that record, and I'll guess which one it is. I'm on a roll. See, so far I've guessed 5 or 6, and I've gotten them all wrong. So.
Well, I can tell you. I'll tell you what. So we're gonna do one of those lifelines from Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Okay.
you already guessed wrong on this train. So we're going to remove from consideration I Want Love.
Okay. Yes, I played that one last time.
Yes, and I can never measure up to it, so I'm not even gonna try.
And we'll remove this train. what's the one? Something triangle.
No.
All right. Forget it. Just play the song.
This one was a single. I don't think it charted very high, but it got a little bit of radio play, and I've been very fond of it ever since. It's called Original Sin.
Ah.
All right. Let me get the words readable here in front of me. This is the kind of song that I hear and I'm like, man, I really wish that I'd written this one. I don't always wish that. I can love a song and not necessarily think, I wish I had written this song. But this one is one of those that comes along and I'm like, I would have been so proud to have authored this piece.
Tell me how you know
Thank you, sir.
Like that one. Love that album. Man, yeah. that whole album's great.
Yeah, just gold. Solid gold.
Yeah, probably one of the last, I mean, this is subjective, albums from Elton John where almost every song was, you know, he was firing on all levels.
Yeah, that's why I think it's kind of the swan song of that era, because everything post that really has been... It's really cool that you still want to make music, and I support that, and I think it's great. But, like, his concerts shifted to greatest hits only. That was, like, the last tour where he really, every show he played, like, you know, five or six songs from the new album and all that stuff. And so.
Yeah. No, I mean, I love the, I think we talked about it last time, just how the production changed on, what was the one before Songs from the West Coast? What was the album before that?
The Big Picture, I think.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and it was just a few years apart, right?
Right. I think so, because if I remember correctly, the releases between that were like a live album and like a duets album and a tribute album and some other stuff. And so there were things under the Elton John banner, but I think that the Big Picture was the last studio album before they did this one. And
yeah.
It did. The production changed, and also... Nigel was back in the band.
Yes.
Not just on stage, but in the studio.
Yeah,
and
he wasn't on. Yeah, he wasn't on every track on Songs from the West Coast, but I think he was on a few of them.
A bunch of them.
Yeah. There was like that transitional period when they did the one night only at the Garden in 2000, when it was Nigel Olsen and there was another guy.
But that was
the
year
also.
Before. So.
Right. But it was still, I think, that transitional time before Nigel was back as the main drummer and has been ever since.
Thank Davey Johnston for that, because
right.
he pretty much was a silent, you know, like a quiet lobbyist. And I think that's made his concerts just eminently better. Nigel, like, you talk about bands. If I had to pick one band in the world, like, if you want to talk about a career that was all about just like the right people got in the room at the same time, it's Elton John. Like,
oh, yeah.
In a way, maybe the Beatles are another example of this, but it's like, my God, he found Nigel and Dee, and then he found Davey and his lyricist, Bernie Taupin, and it was just like there was something special brewing in the collaborations that he did with everybody, and Elton was a special guy, but the people that were around him were like the perfect fit. You know,
yeah.
And I just can't imagine his career having done what it did without, you know, lining up with those people.
Yeah, and seeing them in concert, I'm so sad that that's over. You know, I've got to see them a lot. The sound, his sound engineer for the live shows is just the best. The best I've heard, I think, consistently. So, you know, nothing tops when the show opens with Funeral for a Friend and you hear Nigel come in on the snare for that first time, and it just it blasts the arena, and it's just amazing.
And the thing that's so great about Nigel, he is the least selfish drummer I have ever heard play. Like, he doesn't do a lot of fills or a lot, but when he decides to go,
oh yeah,
it counts. It stands out. It's like
amazing.
He picks the perfect place.
Amazing,
love it.
Amazing.
Anyway.
Cool.
What do you got for us?
I'm going to do a song by The Killers that I love.
Right on.
This is called Human. Have you heard this one, Steve?
I don't know. Play it.
Oh, by the way, I'm dealing with an issue here. A sticky B.
A sticky B?
Yeah, look. It's, I don't know if you can see it there, but it's sometimes it's worse than others. So I'm hoping that I can unscrew this and fix whatever's going on with this key.
I think it's fortuitous that it was a B.
Yeah.
It sounds like there's honey stuff.
Yeah, look at that.
Wouldn't be anywhere near as effective if you'd have said, I have a sticky A flat.
Yes.
All right, I'll get out of your way.
I did my best to notice when the call came down the line to the platform of...
Thomas, sorry, I didn't mean to call you a bastard. It wasn't you. I thought it was somebody else that was watching. Thank you, Steve, for highlighting that. Let me start that again.
I did my best to notice when the call came down the line. Up to the platform of surrender, I was brought, but I was kind. Sometimes I get nervous when I see an open door. Close your eyes, clear your heart. Cut the cord. Are we human? Or are we dancer? My sign is vital. My hands are cold. For the answer, are we you? Are we dancer? Pay my respects to grace and virtue. Send my condolences to God. Give my regards to soul and romance. They always did the best they could. So long to devotion. You taught me everything I know. Wave goodbye, wish me well. You gotta let me go. Are we human? Or are we dancer? My sign is vital. Sign is vital. My hands are cold, and I'm on my knees looking for the answer. You gotta let me know. Are we human? Or are we dancing? My sign is vital.
That's a beautiful song. I definitely have to check that out. I've never heard that before.
Yeah, it's a good one.
What vintage is that? 90s? 2000s?
No, that was the 2000s. It, that there's no piano in it. It's a super produced song. There's a lot going on in it, but it's just a great, great song. Love that.
Yeah, like I'm going to need to kind of lean on you over the next 10 years to like introduce me to the good songs from the 90s and the 2000s and the 2010s, because, you know, obviously as the audiences that we play for evolve, I'm going to have to include more of that. And
yeah, it's a funny thing.
Yeah. I've just always been very resistant to that, because living through them, when you have to listen to, when you, the charts are full of the good and the crap at the same time, I have a hard time with that. So
yeah, you know, it's funny because every generation seems to do the same thing. They musician or not, they lose, after a certain age, I guess, they lose touch with what is current. You know, when I was a kid, the Grammys was a huge deal, or the MTV Video Music Awards, and I was so in tune with what was happening in music, the TRLs and that kind of stuff. That was kind of my thing growing up. But I'm so disconnected, and I have been for a while, from top 40 radio. And every once in a while, I mean, I'll have it on in my car just to kind of see what's going on out there. And sometimes I have to learn a song for a gig. But other than that, it's like, yeah, every generation says it. They don't make songs the way they used to. And I feel that way. And the people that are younger than you are, than I am, are going to say it about their shitty music.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. All right, man. Well, I'm going to play. I wasn't sure which one I was going to do. I had a few things rolling around, but our friend and our viewer here, Norman, chimed in with a great suggestion from the album The One. And I just want to take 1 second and talk about this one. This song is about it's about a guy suffering from AIDS, reconnecting with his dad.
The last song.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think this is really important because this came out in 1992. And, you know, we were really fairly close to when Freddie Mercury had died from AIDS. Magic Johnson had come out publicly with his diagnosis within like a year or so of this. And this is, to me, something that really imprints heavily on this era of Elton John music, because during the 80s, you know, it was a disease that was spreading most aggressively in the gay community. Certainly it was not limited to gay people, but it was really, really, and no one knew anything about it. And Elton kind of did what most people did in the 80s, which is stick his head in the sand, you know, and he felt really ashamed of himself by the end of the 80s, because a lot of his friends got this disease and died. And when Ryan White, this kid that got it through a blood transfusion, was a big fan of his.
And people made fun of him.
He got kicked out of his school. They wouldn't let him go to school. They had to move to a new town. And so Elton helped his family. Elton helped this kid's family buy a new house in a new town and get established. And when he got so sick that he just couldn't go to school anymore and it was clear he was going to die, Elton actually spent a couple of weeks at that in the new town with his mom, and he would do things like answer the phone for her and whatnot. And it was this really, really profound experience for him, because this kid had this amazing attitude, and so did his parents, even with what they were going through. And at this particular time, Elton was at the absolute lowest ebb. He was an alcoholic, he was addicted to cocaine, was bulimic, he was really and kind of feeling sorry for himself all the time, in spite of all of the blessings that he'd had in his life. And he really made a commitment to clean himself up, because he was so inspired by the White family. And when he came out of rehab, he started the Elton John AIDS Foundation. And to date, they've been able to deliver about $300 million of
It's incredible.
Treatment and research dollars.
Before you play it, I do want to add something to this song, if you don't mind. Now, I don't mean to add any kind of light to this, because it's a very serious song and a very serious subject, but the reason that I am familiar with the song is not because I heard it on Elton's album or I heard it at all, is, as you know, I'm a lifelong Howard Stern fan, and
Yeah, and you like him, and you like him when he was the absolute worst human being on the planet.
This is kind of from that era. And, you know, his producer of the show, Gary, they call him Baba Booey. I'm sure you've heard that before. They were talking about something, a conversation came up about people who cry, guys who cry on, can cry like this. And they were talking about how Gary's brother died of AIDS in the early 90s. And that they were saying Gary can cry on command if he hears this song from Elton John. And they're like, oh, well, is it, you know, your song? Is it Tiny Dancer? So they say, no, it's the last song. And they bring Gary into the studio. And in an instant, he starts talking about, no, it's the last song. It was, you know, about the dad going to visit his son who was dying of AIDS, which he said was something that happened in his life. But he started crying immediately, and they all started making fun of him. So that was how I heard about
it. It's really, really a sweet story, Kevin.
No, you got to see the clip because it's funny. It is funny. It's in good fun.
All right.
Don't take my word for it.
Well, anyway, I've been moved by the transformation in Elton's music, and he started donating like all of the profits that came in off of singles to it. And so anyway, this was one of the first songs that came out that after he went back to the studio after all of that. So thanks for the suggestion, Norm. All right, Kevin, I'm taking you off the screen so you can
sit in
silence.
Before I tell you another story about it, yeah.
Yeah, so you can sit in silence and think about whether what you just said was appropriate, young man. Okay. Okay, I haven't done this one in a long time, so I may get something wrong in it, but beautiful tune. Yesterday, you came to lift me up. Light as straw, brittle as a bird. Today, I weigh less than a shadow on the wall. Just one more whisper. Unheard tomorrow, leave the windows open. As fear grows, please hold me in your arms. Won't you help me if you can to shake this anger? I need your gentle hand. Skin, I can't believe you love me. I never thought you'd come. I guess I misjudged love between a father and his son. Come together, the hidden truth no longer haunting me. Tonight we touched on the things that were never spoken. That kind of understanding sets me free, 'cause I never I only thought I'd win. I never dreamed I'd feel this fire beneath my skin. I can't believe you love me. I never thought you'd come. I guess I misjudged love between a father and his son.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Operation Shutdown said, somewhere I hope Gary Dell'Abate is listening.
Yes, and I hope he's crying. And I hope somebody's there to make fun of him for it.
No, I'll send you the clip. It's funny.
No, I'm sure. Look, you know that I literally find everything funny.
I know.
I just don't.
99% usually, of which we can't discuss.
I just don't usually broadcast it.
Right, I know.
To people.
Yeah, I'm having an off night.
Kind of revealing our hand to people.
There's a bunch of people. Why? There's somebody from India, which I haven't really seen before, I don't think. I see someone from Japan. Really, a lot of people all over the world. It's pretty awesome.
I know. That's my favorite thing about doing this. Yeah, and that's my favorite thing about YouTube is I've been able to reach a lot of people that, you know, you sure don't get to reach by playing at the local bar.
Yeah. I was looking at the time to see if I have time for one or two more, because I'm going to have to probably wrap up like at, I think I have time for, maybe, don't want to play, I'll play this one.
All right.
Remember the other day we were talking about the Billy Joel video of the new song, Turn the Lights Back On, and how, you know, they did the AI flashbacks to how he looked through the different stages of his life. And it's crazy because you look at those eras and it's a completely different guy than that we have today. I mean, obviously he's 75 years old, right?
He's one where you have a hard time looking at him today and finding the connective tissue back
I know.
To the dude from like 1989.
It's really amazing. I mean, look, it's everybody ages. There's nothing we can
right,
do
but
about that.
You look at Elton today and look at Elton in 1976 and you can see like a line from guy turning into this guy.
A bit, yeah.
But Billy Joel, my God, you wouldn't even, like, if he just disappeared off the face of the planet and then reemerged, no one would know who
it
was.
It's true. He probably likes it. It gives him a little bit more anonymity, right?
Yeah.
But anyways, I was watching the Matter of Trust Russia documentary. And that's one of the Billy Joel eras, I think, that we all really loved. And it got me, I was going down the rabbit hole on YouTube, and I came across a video of Billy Joel playing Leningrad at Madison Square Garden in 2015. And Victor was in the front row. Have you seen that clip?
I have.
You've seen it? Yeah.
And did you know that Victor actually sent me a private message after I posted Leningrad on YouTube.
You had to go and one-up me tonight.
It was one of the coolest things
ever.
That's
amazing. I didn't know that. How did you not tell me that before?
I don't know. It never came up. We were telling fart jokes.
Oh, send that over to me.
Yeah. So Victor and I are Facebook friends.
Wow.
And it's like the coolest thing ever.
I want to be friends with Victor.
Yeah, I'll send you his stuff. He would love and send him a link to you playing.
Now I'm gonna go. I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna have to record the song.
He's a super nice guy, and he is, you know, like, yeah, just he's everything this song is about.
Yeah. So wow, that's amazing. I got to talk about that. But now the pressure's on. If I'm gonna record it, and I'm gonna tag him, and he doesn't respond, then you know.
Oh, he'll respond.
Be saying a lot. Yeah.
Don't worry. I'll put in a good word.
Now, should I change the piano sound for this? You tell me. I'll see. Or, because on there, it's really a bright piano sound. Let's see. Does that sound more like it? What do you think?
It does, but I would probably still use the other one because when the band comes in, it's more resonant.
Yeah, or I can use the other one and put a brighter. Yeah, because I had it on like a mid brilliance, so I'm going to put this on a bright brilliance.
But I mean, who am I to tell you how to do your job, man?
Yeah, that's all right. Hold on. Oh, let's see. Okay.
Maybe don't use that, though.
No, yeah. There's a time and place for that.
All right, man. All right. I'll get out of your way.
Leningrad.
Kill it. Just kill it.
Hopefully not like I killed scenes.
Favorites, man.
Me too. And I mess up those chords and mess up the jump at the end with the chorus. I put on a church organ instead of the choir.
Well, you should definitely be shamed and run out of town
for
that.
I'm definitely not sending that one to Victor.
Well, when you get the right one up, you let me know and I will direct Victor right to it because he would love you.
Yeah.
He really would. He's a super guy. He's on Facebook and Instagram both.
Oh, cool. I'm going to do that. I'm definitely going to do that. I'm going to write it down right now, actually, because if it's not on my reminders list, it doesn't happen.
Right, because you have things going on besides this. I don't.
A few.
You guys, you're looking at my life right now, guys. But Kevin, like, you know, he's got feedings and groceries, and he's putting podcasts together, and he's, and I'm sitting here thinking to myself what songs I might want to learn next so that I can go on and play for people for free.
Anyway. I'm going to have to leave at like 6:55. So
yeah, I've got time. I figured I would play what would potentially be my last song, and then if you want to do one more, you can, and then if you need to leave, then I can finish it out. But
I may not have time, so I'll say goodbye to everybody now. I'll stick around while you're still playing.
Yeah, and then maybe we can do a little sign-off together at the end.
I'll let you know. If I'm not here, then I'll just,
you're not here,
I'll just leave this on. You'll see that, you know, me not sitting here.
Right. Okay. Well, we'll figure that out, okay?
Okay.
But I'm gonna do a song from the Lion King soundtrack that I had the pleasure of seeing Elton do twice, which is sort of a rarity, but he included it in the Million Dollar Piano show in Vegas, which was the second of his runs there. And I don't know, this song resonates with me at the time in my life that I'm at because, you know, there's a generational, like, a lot of people that I love are probably going to be making their transition to the Beyond the Rainbow Bridge over the next few years, and people that I loved are retiring, and, you know, just stuff is happening. There's a lot of change happening. In your 40s, it's very different than in your 30s. So I'm very, this is a poignant message. So, Kevin, thanks. I had a good time tonight, as always. And
it was, you know, I was a little off tonight. I started off on a bad note by screwing up a scene from an Italian restaurant.
I didn't notice anything out of the ordinary with you.
It was just about perfect. You thought it was Billy Joel playing it.
No, I just thought it was you.
Oh, yeah. So hopefully,
sounded just like you all night long.
Thank you. And this went pretty well. Hopefully, at this rate, we'll do this again at some point next year. So,
hopefully in April sometime. We'll talk about it. All right. I'll have my people contact your people, and then they can contact their people.
Sounds good. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Steve. All right.
You too, man. Okay, so this is a song about change and endings, but also renewal and beginnings.
That leap of faith.
by the wayside. Some of us soared to the stars. Some of us sailed through our troubles. Some have to live with the scars. There's far too much to take in here. More to find than can never be. Thank you very, very much for joining us. We enjoy doing this, and we appreciate you tuning in, even though we aren't really taking requests on these little experimental shows that we're doing. But it's fun for us to banter a little bit and hang out where we can actually talk instead of just chat with each other all the time. And it's really fun to explore songs that maybe we wouldn't get the chance to play most of the time because they wouldn't be high on the request list, either out in front of people in person or even at our live stream shows. So you guys, thank you for giving us this excuse. We really enjoy it. And I'm going to hang it up for the night. Now that Kevin's back on dad duty and all kinds of other stuff, but... If you're a musician, please remember, if you're not having fun when you're making music, you're doing it wrong. And as I like to say at the end of all my shows, if you give as much love as you can to as many people as you can, as often as you can. All right, guys? Because none of us knows when this ride comes to an end for us. You don't want any regrets. Leave it all in the field. All right. Take care, and we'll probably do another one of these maybe in late April, okay? Going to try and do it at least once a month. Take care, everyone.